senior national correspondent Terry Moran joining us here now, along with ABC News Supreme Court contributor Kate Shaw for more. Terry, let's start with you. You were outside the court early this morning. We talked then. Yes, yeah. You're already putting in a major day here. What stood out to you so far? I know you've been listening to everything from the beginning.
You know, I was so struck, Kira, by listening to how the conservative majority of justices on the Supreme Court in this remarkable argument approached that fateful issue of overruling Roe versus Wade. And what was striking about it is they weren't deciding, they weren't talking about whether they should do it, but how. How they would essentially undo, maybe not overrule, but gut and undo Roe versus Wade. And leading the way, Chief Justice John Roberts, who openly said that the idea of viability as a line in the law, right now under Roe and other cases, the states are prohibited from banning abortions before a fetus is viable, can survive outside their womb, about 24 weeks. And John Roberts, first he cited the private papers of Harry Blackmun, but that's a different story. John Roberts said, well, why is that? That's really not that important. And that was like a starting gun going off for the other conservative justices. Amy Coney Barrett said, you know, why, getting back to first principles, are we talking about viability? This has been in the law now for 50 years. And it was the Chief Justice who led the way saying, you know, let's get rid of viability. What else can we do here? So they may not, my own sense, and I'd love to hear what Kate would say, I don't think they may or may not overrule Roe, but there's not going to be much left of it either way.
Well, okay, I have a follow-up, but you mentioned Kate. Kate, let's talk about that. You want to follow up on that and tell us what stood out to you?
Sure. Well, I agree with Terry. I was struck by how strong the Chief Justice appeared to be in his skepticism of Roe and Casey and the viability line that Casey drew. Going into the argument, I think we all thought that the Chief Justice and maybe Justices Kavanaugh and Barrett were the real justices to watch because their votes might be in play. Chief Justice Roberts, in the last big abortion case before the court, actually voted to strike down a Louisiana abortion law, though he's no fan of constitutional protection for abortion historically. But I agree with Terry. He seemed very skeptical of the viability line, inclined to uphold this Mississippi 15-week ban. And I think even more than Terry, I got the sense that rather than just kind of gut or narrow Roe and Casey, they're pretty likely to overturn those decisions outright. My strong sense coming out of the argument today was that the justices were less concerned about, you know, potential public blowback if they do overturn Roe and Casey than they were about, you know, actually rejecting these precedents that a majority of the justices believe were deeply flawed. And so that's my prediction coming out. We are going to see Roe and Casey overturned.
Wow. So Kate's, you know, she's making a bold statement there where we kind of think where they're going.
I
trust both of you, actually. I look to both of you as the experts here. So what do you think? Do you kind of get a sense for where they're going to lean here?
I do, because the other thing that struck me in this argument is there was a passionate discussion, really passionate, about what this would mean for the court, right? It was Justice Sonia Sotomayor who asked point blank, how will the court survive the stench? That's what she said.
Wow.
Of overturning a ruling that's 50 years old just because a few new justices have come on the court. And that triggered a whole discussion of how 50 years, generations of people, women and men, have come to rely on Roe in many, many ways. Healthcare is arranged around this right and other things like that. But I agree with Kate. It did sound like that wasn't as much of a problem for several of the justices, whether they can get to enough to outright overrule Roe. It's hard to say, but it certainly means that there's not much left. But to hear Justice Breyer, Justice Kagan, Justice Sotomayor talk about what will this do to the trust, the confidence, the legitimacy that Americans have in this court, when it's pretty clear it's just because some new justices got here that you now have the power to do what we have said again and again and again. This isn't just one case. It's not just two cases. It's a whole line of precedents over 50 years saying women have this right. And it does sound like they're going to undo it, at least if not overrule it.
Well, you know, what does that tell us about this court dynamic, how they think, how they interact, how they get along? I mean, this is an interesting insight.
Yeah, you know, I think what it says is that these conservatives feel emboldened that they are, by their own numbers and by what's happening in the country. You know, the country is certainly in the throes of great division. They come from one side of that division, and I think increasingly are reluctant to try to reach across to the other side. Some of them are just quite activist conservative judges, far more activist than the conservatives of, you know, of 20, 30 years ago. They are willing to reach in and make major changes because they have those seats. Even no matter what it does to the law. That's my feeling. Much more activist justices.
Kate, what do you think?
I mean, I think in terms of the dynamic at the court we saw today, it is the John Roberts court in name only in many respects. So the Chief Justice, you know, his name is attached to the court, but he's actually not really in control. The five justices to his right, led in many ways by Justice Clarence Thomas, are the ones who are going to be calling the shots in terms of the future trajectory of American law. But I do agree that, you know, the newest justices on the court, Justice Barrett and Justice Kavanaugh, you know, I think we thought going into the argument today, you know, might ask tough questions of both sides and might not particularly show their cards. And that wasn't really the sense that I got from their questions. Justice Kavanaugh repeatedly sort of posed the question to, I think, maybe all of the advocates we heard from this morning. Isn't it true that the Constitution is neither pro-choice nor pro-life? Essentially making the point that we should just give to the states, which will make different choices about how and whether to protect abortion, the power to do this thing that the court essentially removed in his framing from the people 50 years ago in Roe versus Wade. And, you know, if that carries the day, you know, Roe is overturned and the states themselves can choose whether to prohibit abortion, whether to protect abortion. You know, Justice Barrett a couple of times referenced adoption. She said, look, to the, you know, challengers, you're suggesting that, you know, it burdens a woman's kind of bodily autonomy to require her to become pregnant and give birth against her will, and it impedes her kind of professional prospects to require her to parent before she wishes to or is ready to do so. And she said, okay, I take the point about bodily autonomy, but, you know, with adoption out there, is it really true that women's professional advancement is stymied if they're required to become pregnant and give birth? And I think the advocates had very effective responses to that. Adoption, you know, has always been an option. That wasn't enough to convince the court in Roe or Casey. And even the decision whether to give a child up for adoption is a decision the Solicitor General said states shouldn't put women to. But I think those questions evidenced real skepticism about the arguments that these abortion restrictions, you know, damage women's autonomy and liberty so dramatically that the right to make these choices is protected by the Constitution.
You know, Kate, I just want to pick up on that moment because that was another shocking moment in some ways. Justice Amy Coney Barrett, who has adopted children herself, openly saying, you know, it's not such a burden to carry a child to term. You can always give up a child for adoption. In other words, the government can compel you in the name of protecting the life of the unborn child to carry a child to term. And she said, that's not really such a burden. You know, it's the real burden is just giving birth, pregnancy and giving birth, but then it's over. And
but
it was
that is such a personal statement to make. And I mean, that can you imagine how many women, you know, Kate, Terry sat back and thought, whoa, wait a minute here. That's not necessarily true, depending on who you are, how old you are, what stage you're in, your life.
Yeah, it was a really striking moment coming, you know, of course, in particular from Justice Barrett, who is herself a mother to adopted children. But certainly I thought that Julie Rickleman, representing the clinic, was very effective in her response, in which she said, you know, it's not just about the, you know, pregnancy, right? Childbirth itself in Mississippi in particular is 75 times more dangerous than a pre-viability abortion. So the state isn't just requiring a woman to, you know, go through 9 months of pregnancy. It's, you know, undergoing this at times unbelievably traumatic and dangerous, you know, wonderful if under the right circumstances, event of giving birth. And again, dangerous in Mississippi in ways that dramatically outpace the danger of a pre-viability abortion. So she did seem to be pushing back against this. Well, you know, what's the big deal if adoption is on the table kind of line? But I did think it was striking that Justice Barrett, and not once, but I believe twice, kind of posed this question. So she's obviously thinking a great deal about this kind of dynamic.
You know, just let's all step back. It's in, you and I joke about this because it shows our age. Kate, we were talking about this early on that everybody always says, well, Terry and I always say, you know, we've been covering this for so long, which is true. I mean, I remember covering these protests in the 80s. I mean, you remember as a young reporter coming on the beat and covering the Supreme Court.
I was in the Supreme Court for Planned Parenthood versus Casey back 30 years ago.
Okay, there you go. And if I can do the numbers right, I was probably right there in the middle of the protests that were taking place now that I think about it. But just think of where we are right now. When you think of 50 years and I even remember being assigned to the protest and thinking, okay, it's going to be the same thing. You've got this side, you got that side. And then next year we'll be doing the same exact thing, having the same conversation. Let's just for a moment put into perspective what's happening today and how this is going to, you know, whether overturned or circumvented, right, Roe versus Wade, how this is going to impact the daily lives of young women who are pregnant, just got pregnant, thinking about getting pregnant, didn't know they were pregnant, and just everything at stake here, the impact of what could happen in the Supreme Court moving forward.
You just captured what happened today and what I think is going to happen in this case, and that is how different life will be for women in America, in many states. Just look at Texas. Just look at Texas. Look at the reporting of our own Rachel Scott, who followed the young woman,
right,
had to travel hundreds of miles. Fortunately, she had the means to do so in order to avail of herself.
She was on birth control.
Yes.
She was doing what she thought was right. She didn't mean to get pregnant,
yes,
and then we followed her journey.
Right. And now in many states in the country, the state government will decide what she does in that moment of her life. It will be a very different kind of America.
All right, we're going to continue this conversation for sure. Kate Shaw, also Terry Moran, thank you so much.
Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.